Also, as we enter into a new season, help us realize that as it is said in the Bible at Ecclesiastes, that there is a season for everything. Help us to always see how meaningless our activities are on this planet without you being a part of our life. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to deviate real quick. I have to do something down front, and I'll ask Mr. Engel to come up here, please. I don't trust you,
huh? You're a smart
man. Something never changed.
Dan, Falmouth County Board of Commissioners expressed sincere appreciation to Dan Engel for unselfish devotion of time, energy, and ability to the people of Falmouth County by serving as County Commissioner from December the 6th, 2004 to June 11th, 2009. Presented this 20th day of July 2009 in Graham, North Carolina. We won't hear that day. But thank you so much.
Thank you.
I know you are doing good in Raleigh, and we're proud of you for being there.
Thank you, Lynn. I just want to say it was an honor and privilege to have worked with every single board member the last 4.5 years. And I know it's a tough position as a county commissioner, but I commend all of you for having the heart of the people there as you make your decisions. And when it's 1 of 5, it's a little different than 120, but you do a good job, and I certainly appreciate that. And outstanding staff here, I thank you, staff. You've done an outstanding job, and it was a blessing for me to serve the people, and again, I really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Yes,
okay, at this time, I know it's time for public comments, but I think I have two. And Miss Everett, are you from Pleasant Grove? But hold on 1 second. What I want you to do is wait until we have the number 4 on your agenda, which is the renovation report, and then we have a new plan, okay? And then I'll let you comment then. And Pat, do you want to wait till then too, honey?
Mine pertains to that anyway.
Okay, no problem. So if y'all will just wait till we get through with number 4, I only have 2 people for comments, and then we'll go back, and we're going to just switch number 4 with number 3, okay? All right, at this time, we're going to talk about the Pleasant Grove Recreation Center renovation. Now, let Mr. Burgess tell you about it.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening.
Good evening.
As you recall, going back to June of 2008, we had a fire at the Pleasant Grove facility there. And I'm going to show you an architect's computer-generated diagram of the facility. I want to tell you a little bit about the fire that happened there, and kind of go through a little bit of the historical stuff, and then get us up to the current, and give you maybe an option that will satisfy the board to maybe be able to move forward. This is the facility. The main road is out here in the front. This is the existing gym facility. They have 2 wings on this building. This wing here and this wing here. This back part here is the boiler room. The fire started primarily in this area, and it spread as far as smoke damage and some other damage to this wing here, this wing here, and some minimal damage into the gym area. Once this fire occurred, then we started working with the insurance adjuster to try to determine the value of the loss of the facility. That took us approximately till April of 2009 to be able to get a final number from the insurance company. A lot of things went into why it took so long, and I won't hash through those tonight, but we finally got to that point. At that point, the insurance adjuster's estimate was that the damage to the facility was $218,195.45. Do have a $25,000 deductible, and so what we would look at being able to recover from the insurance company on this facility is $193,195.45. That does not include contents damage. We started looking at that point at some options prior to actually us getting the final numbers, but looked at some options and had brought in the architect, Lucian Routon, and his firm to start looking at some different options. they went and looked at what the insurance company was willing to pay us, and they took and determined what the actual cost of those repairs would be. Their number was somewhere short of $300,000 as to what that was going to cost, not including actually adding a fire alarm system into the facility, which is about $42,000. So if you add that in, you're looking at about $338,000. All that does is get the facility back to what it was like before the fire. So it's a pre-fire, bare bones repair of the facility. The problem is that facility was built, I would think, around 1930. So you had some problems before the fire occurred, and if you did that amount of repair, all you're doing is getting it back to its pre-fire condition, which, to be honest with you, was not in excellent shape itself. At that same time, we looked at them, what would it take to do a full restoration of that facility? That number, not including the fire alarm system, was $543,000. That was basically taking the existing structure and going back in and making some improvements to it. Following that meeting on April 20th of 2009, we then again requested from the architect, and I put in the memo that the board requested, but it may have actually came from staff. We wanted to look at what would be probably the best use of that facility as far as remodeling it, and what were maybe another option that it would entail. And so what the architect came up with was actually removing this wing here, removing the boiler room here, so that it's in red, and actually remodeling this area here, and possibly dividing it up into different areas so that it could handle offices for staff, handle area for maybe fitness equipment for a multi-purpose room and those types of things, and then actually coming back and trying to refurbish the gymnasium. That estimate was $636,949. So when we got those estimates in, at the cost of that, we got looking at, are there some other options that are a little bit more viable? The problem we have is that the county does not own this facility. The county leases this from the school system, been leasing it since the early 70s. The school system seems to be more inclined, based on communications that staff had with the school system, they're more inclined to lease the property to us than to sell it to us. If we were going to put a lot of money into this property at the tune of $600,000 or more, we really need to own that property. The problem is, in order to acquire it, if the school system would let us purchase it from them, you're looking at having to buy that property, so that's going to cost the county money, plus do the repair work. As I said, the school system is more inclined for a long-term lease situation, which would be agreeable to the staff as far as to do that. So we started looking at, what are some other options here? So we started looking at, is there another option that may be more viable? And this is the kind of the more current option, and the one that we would like for the board to consider tonight. What we looked at the possibility of doing was going in and actually having this wing here removed, this back wing here removed, and this boiler room here removed, and taking the insurance proceeds, because the insurance proceeds are based on the building, that's not any of the county's funds, taking the insurance proceeds and using all of that money to refurbish the gymnasium, to actually make some improvements to it. Once we remove all of these facilities here, is actually bring in a permanent structure, somewhat permanent structure here of about 2,200 to 2,500 square feet that could facilitate the programs that they need to offer up in this area. So what we looked at is actually a similar type structure that the county currently has, and I'll show this to you. This is actually the office complex at our landfill. This facility was actually constructed about 2 years ago. It actually was constructed off-site and brought on-site. It was constructed on-site. It's called a modular unit. However, modular units are built by the state building code standards. So it's built similar to if somebody had built this on-site. It's built very similar to that because it has to meet the state building code. They just happen to construct it at the factory, and then they're able to bring it in and then actually finish the construction on-site. This is a little bit under a 1,600 square foot unit that they have at our landfill. It's accommodating their needs very well. The facility is well built. It has a good look to it. Now, what we would be looking at getting for the Pleasant Grove site would look different than this, but this kind of gives you an idea as to the quality of what the structure would look like. Now, the next slide I have here is to kind of show you what the facility inside, and this is just a conceptual plan that the staff actually came up with. It hasn't been run by the architect or anything other than I sent it to him just for him to have a copy of it. What we would like to do is, in this the size of this facility is approximately 2,200 square feet. If you move forward with this project, then of course the final design will probably differ from this somewhat. Let me just kind of walk you through how this community center would be set up. You, of course, would enter here. You'd have restrooms, both men and women's handicap restrooms on both right and left sides. We would have office space for the recreation and park staff here. We'd have three offices plus some storage for them. This diagram on the right end has an exercise room and a lounge area. It's about 640 square feet, allow enough room for their fitness equipment. And then also this area here is an area that's 10 by 7. It would provide enough space for them to maybe have sofas and have a sofa and some chairs and maybe a TV for them while they're kind of waiting for exercise equipment, or if it's just a place for them to be able to gather. The other area, which is a multi-purpose room, is 750 square feet. It would actually be, it would have a refrigerator, a sink, a stove, and then have a closet area, so they could actually prepare some meals there. They could have meals catered in. They could use this for crafts. They could use this for luncheons. They could use this for actually just a general meeting space if they wanted to use it for that purpose. This one, if you're using tables in here, you could probably get estimating probably 30 to 40 people around tables. If you were to have just a group that was simply going to sit in chairs for a presentation, you maybe could get 50 or 60 maybe in that room. I think the fire code will allow 75 people in there, but I don't think that you could get that many actually in there. So that would provide enough space for basically what they're actually were doing at the Pleasant Grove site prior to the fire. They would basically be able to do everything at this site that they were doing pre-fire with the addition of this community center. Let me back up here. What we would probably envision is, of course, as I mentioned earlier, these wings would be removed. We would probably have the modular unit constructed right here with some parking in this area, maybe some parking even out in front of the modular unit. Again, staff would be here. People also that would use this facility would have access to the gymnasium also. One of the things that would actually probably need to be done differently is they had a Friday night band and a actually performed in here. What they would have to do if anybody wanted to do that type of setup, they would probably have to do it in the gymnasium. That'd be the only place on site that could be done. It would be something where they'd probably have to take up and set down each time they had an event like that. Other than that, I mean, Brian can verify this, but other than that, I think all the programs that were there pre-fire could be brought back to the facility with this type of setup. Now, the question is, how would we pay for this? Of course, the renovations to the gym, we would actually use, as I mentioned earlier, we'd use the insurance proceeds to actually do the renovations to that. For this new community center building, what we would look at is actually paying that out of the fund balance, so we would not have to borrow any money to be able to do that. We're estimating that facility would cost around $200,000. Currently, we have set aside for utilities on this building here, $19,400 a year. We anticipate that we'll be able to save about $10,000 on the utilities on the new configuration versus the old configuration. So one option is that we could leave the level of utility cost in the budget each year, any savings that we have in utilities, and we could put that back, that would automatically go back into fund balance each year. And over time, you could actually repay the cost of some of this, the cost of this this unit that we would have constructed on the site. So over time, it would repay some of that money. Couple things. If the board does authorize us to move forward with this, we will actually come back with you in the future to bring the bids back to you. The bids for the renovations to the gymnasium and the bids on the purchase of the modular unit, so we would bring those back to you at some point in the future for you to approve that. What we're looking at tonight is being able to get the board's approval to move forward with this plan. One thing that is contingent on is us being able to get a long-term lease agreement with the school system. The manager has had a discussion with the superintendent, and that looks very favorable that we would be able to get that. Terms that would be suitable to staff as far as to move forward and to be willing to invest this type of money in that project. One nice thing about the structure that would be put on that site, if for some reason in the future that we did lose that space up there, that unit could be actually moved off of that property. So we could actually, the county could go and purchase another site somewhere and move that to that site. So in the future, they'd still be able to have a community center in that area. So that's one of the advantages of using this type of facility. Okay. Ryan, did you have anything to add?
No, we've had numerous meetings in the Pleasant Grove community. There's some folks here this evening from up there too. We've had two of our Recreation Parks Commission meetings up there. I think what I would feel comfortable telling you when coming away from that is there's a desire to have these activities brought back to the site. There's a love for the building, yes, There's a lot of history in that building. But I think that the desire to have the programs take place there would probably override that. And to be able to have this configuration would let us bring back everything with the exception of the dance, and it would need to be relocated into the gym. But all the other programs, we've been over this plan with Tim. I feel like the setup, some kind of setup of that unit, like he's demonstrated tonight, would let us be able to bring back everything we were doing before.
And what's square footage of the addition?
Between 2,200, the diagram I had on the board was about 2,200 square feet, so it'd be somewhere between 2,200 and 2,500 square feet. One thing I did want to elaborate on a little bit more that Brian brought up. After the meeting on April the 20th, Brian did go and meet with the community out there, showed them the latest plan that the architect had done. There was a lot of support for that. But once we got that plan back and once we started looking at the cost and all that, that's when we had to kind of see if there was another viable option. So Brian went out there in good faith carrying the design out there for them to look at. It was something in-house that we had to really take a relook at when the cost started escalating. And that's why we chose not to go with that plan and to go with maybe another option.
Okay. Any more questions?
I just want to make a couple comments. I went to school board retreat last week, and their board actually did vote to do a 25-year lease to us. And they've got that in agreement. I mean, they're working on it. Of course, they'll have to bring it to their board as to how to do it. And I assume Clyde and Craig needs to get with them. Also, one thing they pointed out at that was that if they give us the land, they have to sell it to us, actually, mm-hmm. fair market value, which...
That's a better deal to lease it then, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, yeah, because about 27 acres or so.
Yeah, right. It's a bunch of land.
Right. And the way we're configuring this with a community center, new structure, that we can take off the property if we have to, and then just using insurance monies to remove the wings and to refurbish the gym, then it kind of is probably the best use of the...
Well, and that works, money. Too, with this type of building. I mean, 25 years, if we get that usage out of it.
Yes, sir.
What kind of floor are you putting in the gym?
Right now, the estimates go back with VC tile, which we would love to look at. That was what was there originally, which is great for... it's okay for basketball. It's not as good as your hardwood. We would not want hardwoods back because we're looking at multi-purpose up here. We get a lot of different use in there besides just basketball. The hardwoods are great for basketball, but when you start walking or dancing or doing anything else on them, not as good. Current budget estimates include VC tile. I've had some discussions with the architect about maybe looking at some other alternative surfacing that's not the hardwood level of cost, but maybe a little bit more adaptable than VC. The floor has been pulled up. All the tile is gone out of there. And the gym in this proposal would see some significant work to it. I think heat and flooring and some work to the restrooms would be done too. But that was needed before. So.
Yeah, kind of our plan on the gym part of it is the insurance proceeds you get, carry them as far as they'll go, as far as the repairs go. We know that once these wings are torn off, then there will be some structural work that'll have to be done on the exterior. And then inside, as Brian mentioned, the heating system, maybe some electrical work, the flooring, and then if there's money left over, possibly the bathrooms could be renovated there also, depending on how far the money will go.
Any other questions from the commissioners?
I'd like to hear from that.
I am. Send me something. Yeah, that's why I asked him to please wait. Okay.
I've got two other items not related to Pleasant Grove that I was just going to run over real quickly. Do you want me to wait and do those after you've heard from the public? Be glad to.
Okay. All right. At this time, I'm going to call Ms. Brenda Everett up and ask her, have you seen this at all, Brenda? Had you seen this plan?
Not this plan that he was talking about.
Okay.
Tonight.
Okay.
I was at the other meeting at the fire department and saw that one. And
let me give you that.
Happy with that one.
That's just the one that I had. So.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. I want this picture, thank you. Okay. I can get another one, I think.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
We're not well represented tonight because the senior adults on a fixed income, and we've been to so many meetings. Gas like it is, they said I can't go and listen to the same thing again. So we have a few here tonight, and we're tickled about the new ideas coming in, but the plan that was presented at the fire department last month, I was not particularly pleased with because of having the exercise room right in where the bingo would be. Mm-hmm. Because at Lakeview, we try to have bingo of a morning, and your office is right there with your little small petitions. Mm-hmm. If they're on the phone, they talk loud, then Ethel's got to talk loud so we can hear the numbers. Mm-hmm. So I knew that wasn't going to work out. To me, this sounds better. Yeah. We're coming along.
I was thrilled when I said
it. It's coming along. I like the different areas with it. I think we could work with that. I think the others would be a little more happy with this. And the man that I talk with at the school seems to think the school wants to work with y'all and coming to an agreement. My next question would be, how well will this one be took care of? Now, Brian has mentioned that the staff took care of the building, but mopping floors, cleaning toilets, there's more to upkeeping to a building than that. You've got electrical work to do. There's plumbing to do. And all this piled up, nothing was done a little bit along. This looks like a nice building. If it comes in, is upkeep going to be kept, or is it going to be let go? Now, we were blessed this time that no one was in the building when the fire happened. Next time, we might not be so blessed. We could be having bingo, or the kids could be playing basketball. And you know, when a fire breaks out, what happens? And you got a building full of people, panic, and people trying to get off the bleachers and getting out. That's what I'm worried about. And you're not, if you don't fully own the property and you're not feeling it's yours, how well is it going to be kept up, and how well is the utilities, the wiring gets bad, is it going to be replaced, or is it just going to be let go? That's my concern.
Well, I think Brian might can answer that question for you.
Well, with Pleasant Grove, you know, when we leased it, so the school system had made a decision to leave it, because they apparently, probably in 73, had decided that it was more cost-effective to go somewhere else, maybe do new construction. And we came in with the idea of using it until it absolutely couldn't be used anymore. That's where we're at right now. But maintaining a property the size and scope of the current Pleasant Grove facility is extremely expensive to do. Compare it to the grounds. It's on 28 acres. Very, very inexpensive to maintain the land. Mow it, keep it up. When you get into the buildings and the systems that it has, it's extremely expensive. I would say that having a modern day building out there that would probably have a heat pump as opposed to a very intricate boiler system, having just two restrooms instead of the numerous that we had, 90% of which were defunct, would make it easier and more affordable to take care of, I believe. I know we use county maintenance a tremendous amount to help us do work to our properties, and a lot of this was beyond their scope because of its age. When you just can't find parts for systems that were installed in the 30s anymore. And those guys have done a great job. And staff, Ms. Evers is absolutely right. Our staff, I'll take this opportunity, and did a fantastic job keeping it clean, keeping it nice and neat, and presentable. She's right. I think what we've done is we've used Pleasant Grove to the point where the current existing building isn't feasible to use anymore. We knew this day was coming. We addressed that in our long-range plan as well. But if you're just taking care of the gym, that limits your cost, your exposure, and this new structure designed a little bit more ergonomically than what we have out there now should be easier.
What kind of heat system are you going to put in the gym?
We've talked about several different kinds. I know an electric system has been discussed. A possible radiant heat would be like propane burners, I think, that hang up in the ceiling. Currently, the whole building is on a boiler system. It's not possible to zone it. This is where we start seeing some of these utility savings. Right now, if I just have staff in the prop, we're heating the entire building in a very antiquated system.
So I think we've talked about some propane burners. Tim may be able to comment on that a little bit more, as well as an electric system. I think we've even discussed the possibility of bringing back a boiler, although I would think it would probably take some significant work on the existing system that's in place now. So.
Okay. Yeah, I think it'll be easier to keep up, too.
And that's been the department's overall desire has been to try to keep these programs going in this interim. And we've heard it made plain to us to try to bring these things back to the property.
And all looks like all will be brought back, but Big Daddy has seemed to have just kind of fallen apart.
Yeah.
So I really don't look for that to come back. Okay. So, but
all right.
I like it.
Okay, thank you, Brenda. Okay, next is Pat Bailey.
Who? I can't react to that.
Opening statement.
I'm not giving you my gavel either.
Loose lips sink ships. I've heard that you're going to repair Eli Whitney facility there, although you've thrown the old ladies out. But down the hill, which doesn't matter. Anyway, recently, I've heard you're going to repair it. Band-Aid. Just recently, some of your maintenance crew or the architects or the scouts or whatever were down looking over the place and, quote, we can pinch this and shortcut that and we can band-aid it because in 4 or 5 years, those old ladies won't be here. Quote, close quote. You're the one who said it?
No, I didn't say it.
Well, the little old ladies have been there putting on the quilting for 75 years. Not on a wishy-washy date, but on the first Thursday in April. So the little old ladies, the word got out in the community that you folks are going to shortchange them, band-aid them, and push them out. So they're about to sit, going to strike and not finish their quilt for the next one in coming up April. Because are you people going to do the repairs beforehand or after the first Thursday in April or in the middle of it?
I think we need to. Mr.
I'm going to cover that.
Okay. Tim's going to cover that, Pat. I didn't know that. He's
The ship has not been sunk then.
I don't know. This is the first I've heard about anybody talking about the.
Well, I'm in the far corner of your kingdom, and you people don't come down there. But you're welcome.
I came down there.
Just hold on to that cane.
I came down there.
Yes, but on your watch said I got to go.
I came down there, you know that.
Any questions? This will be about the 7 that many years they've been having it. Mm-hmm. It does bring good PR for the county. The ladies said they would not go take it someplace else, like Eli Whitney, Alexander Wilson, something. They said, all these volunteers. And they're doing their quilts, and you can't pay for the quilts, and you people haven't got a PR fund going. And it's a real good thing in your behalf, so I would suggest that if you're going to repair something, count the old lady still being alive.
Okay. Thank you.
Questions?
Huh? Shake it.
Hold it.
I can do that.
Pat, you're going to get some bad publicity out of that.
I can
see Tim laying in the floor right now.
Pat knows where I live. I can't say anything.
If there's that question,
hey,
Tim,
I'm going to let Mr. Burgess.
We'll let Mr. Burgess come up now and talk about that,
my
Pat.
My camera's not working.
Sure he wants to.
Loose lips. Watch them.
Thank you, Pat.
That was the second issue to address with board tonight. The status of the Eli Whitney facility gymnasium. We also had the architect take a look at that one to try to give us cost estimates on the repairs to that facility. Those range anywhere from $463,478 up to $691,109. So that's the range on those. The problem we've got with that, and those are higher than what we had originally anticipated they would be. The problem is the roof on that building needs to be replaced. The floor needs significant work done to it. The heating system needs to be replaced. There's a possibility of the windows on the front of the building need to be replaced. There's just a lot of issues with that facility. What Brian's going to do, and we're not asking the board to take any action on Eli Whitney tonight, but what Brian is going to do is begin to have a meeting or meetings with the residents in that community to explain to them the situation of the facility, explain the cost, and all of those things, have some discussions with them. At some point in the future, we would like to come back to the board with a plan for what we need to do in that community, and so we want to just give Brian an opportunity to meet with the residents there. Okay. To work that out.
Okay.
All right. Third item. This is just a correction from our last meeting. When I did the presentation on facility improvement plan, I wanted to correct some of the numbers I gave you on the county office building court annex project, which was part of that overall facility improvement plan. We actually had three local bids instead of two. There were three local bidders. In the minutes, the original minutes you got, it showed that there were 12 local bidders of all the projects. That was, I'm sorry, it showed there were 13 local bidders. It actually was 12 local bidders on the project. I just want to let you know. You do have the corrected minutes there. Okay. That was a change that was made in there to reflect 12 local bidders instead of 13.
Okay.
So at this time, we would go back to the Pleasant Grove issue. And what we're asking for tonight is for the board to consider moving forward with the plan of tearing down the wings, refurbishing the gymnasium using the insurance proceeds, purchase of a modular unit. We anticipate it'll be around $200,000 that will be put on site there, and that we would bring those bids back both on the construction phase and on the modular unit phase at the time in which we do receive bids on that. The board has already adopted a resolution a while back appointing the architectural firm of Routon Nicholson and DeLuca to do the architectural work on that, so we would be using them for the gym portion. We don't think there would be, we'd be really working more with the bidders and the companies on the modular unit itself. So.
Tim, question.
Yes, ma'am.
Who would be tearing down these wings? Or would that go out to bid?
That would go out. We got, early on, we got some quotes on those. We would be sending that out for more quotes, I'm sure, I would think. That was anticipated to be about, I think it was $50,000+ to tear both of the wings down. We'd already gotten.
And the boiler room.
And the boiler room, too. We had gotten quotes from, I think, two companies before.
I got one question on the septic system. I know it's on the other side of the building. Have y'all investigated that any?
Brian has had some initial discussions, I think, with environmental services about that. A couple of things here. There are several restrooms in these buildings that, I'm correct in that, Brian, that there are several restrooms, that once these are torn down, of course, we will not have, these will no longer be on that same system. There are a couple of restrooms, two men's and women's restrooms in the front of the building. We're not sure right now what we'll have to do with this one. We're hoping that either we can use the existing system because we're pulling all of these restrooms off,
right,
or that we'll have to do a separate system, whichever is less expensive, in order to accommodate the new facility.
I know that's bad land around there for that septic. I was just curious if you had.
Yeah, we've had some initial discussions. I don't know if you want to elaborate on what environmental services. You've had some brief discussions.
We have. We feel fairly confident that the work to the restrooms inside the gym that would be left. That system that was in place, our understanding, was to handle the entire school. That wing that is not in red was the cafeteria for the school. So the system is out there now, the tank. Lines and such were designed for that. Hopefully, we feel fairly certain that the work to the restrooms inside the gym that will be left should be able to work on its system. That may be a little bit more questionable with coming in with this modular unit and then trying to tie on it, but we would only have two restrooms going into the modular, so hopefully it wouldn't be anything. If it required a new system, it shouldn't be on the scale close to what's out there for the gymnasium building now, but it may.
What type of search are you going to, execute to see who can put up this addition?
Well, what we'll do is, and we're going to kind of work with the landfill staff because they actually prepared the bid documents when they did that facility there, put them together, sent them out to, and I wasn't part of that process, but my understanding is they sent them out to several different companies and then had them bid on them to see what the cost was for that facility. We would do something similar to that on this project. So we would get all the bid specifications, bid documents prepared, and then we would send it out to several companies for them to submit bids on.
And how are you going to research the companies? That's what I'm trying to ask.
Well, there is, we know of one local company that does this kind of work.
There's many.
Sure, there probably are.
And not only can you, you can try to, depends on what the style is that you want. You can either go in for a residential, type of office building look, or you can go in for an institutional type look. there are several approaches that you can make and probably come out, you know, square foot cost.
About the same.
Right. Then that one, because that one there you're looking at, it's more of a residential look, even though it's a commercial building, it's kind of got a residential look
right
in front. And that one was done for, and this is including the phone system, I think it was a fire alarm system was put in it, septic, everything was done. That one's for 130-some thousand, I think, and it was about 1,500-some square feet. The facility itself, getting the facility brought in, getting it the foundation done and the HVAC work was only 103,000 on about 1,500-some square feet. So per square foot cost, it's a lot better than actually constructing a commercial building on site.
And we're not going by way of the architect on these other buildings?
On the structure that we would bring in, no, we would not. We don't anticipate having to use an architect.
These companies have their own engineers. Stamp them, and that saves some money up front.
Okay. Any more questions for Mr. Burgess? Do I hear, at this time, I'm going to call for a motion. Do I hear a motion that we accept this proposal? It seems like that the people in Pleasant Grove may like this idea. Ms. Everett liked it.
So moved.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. All righty.
Okay. You've done a good job.
Yeah,
good
time. That's good.
But a lot of people have been working. A lot of people have been working on this project, so it's taken a lot of people coming together. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. At this time, I'm gonna call on Mr. Leonard, our fire marshal, to tell us about the 800 megahertz grant. 800.
Madam Chair.
The $500,000 grant. All right.
Yes, ma'am.
Gotcha.
Commissioners, I appreciate the opportunity to come to you tonight to speak on the $500,000 grant. As a follow-up to the presentation at the April 6, 2009 budget retreat by the United States Representatives Howard Coble and Brad Miller, staff was notified on July 23, 2009 by the United States Department of Justice of the application process for the $500,000 800 megahertz grant. This application was completed and submitted on August 11, 2009. As a part of the grant application, the following equipment was listed for purchase. The first is a Mobile Communications Command Center. The Mobile Communications Command Center will be immediately incorporated into the County Emergency Services Agency fleet, being utilized for community projects and policing efforts. It will also serve as a 911 communications center backup in the event that the current 911 communications center is unable to operate. It will also serve as an on-site incident command vehicle in the event of a large emergency incident. The second item for purchase is a 50-foot antenna, which will be located at our new EOC in the Family Justice Center. This will provide us an additional backup system, a stationary system, for Alamance County's 911 Communications Center. This system will allow continued dispatch of emergency incidents in the event that the 911 Communications Center becomes inoperable. There'll be four permanent dispatch stations located within this emergency operations center, and this 50-foot antenna will be needed to provide that dispatch. The third item is four additional talk channels. It is expected that our emergency services agency could possibly expand or increase the radio technology within the next few years. An increase in radio traffic is also expected with this increase in technology and equipment. The additional 800 megahertz channels purchased via this grant will allow Alamance County to accept this increased radio traffic and allow communications to continue in a timely manner throughout Alamance County. The fourth item that we wish to purchase with this grant is a 6-unit portable gang charger. Each emergency services agency will receive a portable gang charger, as well as our mobile communications and command trailer and our air truck, which responds on all major structure fire and incidences throughout the county. The fifth item are Motorola Impress batteries. 75 additional batteries for these gang chargers, as well as for our emergency operations center and our mobile command communication center, will be purchased. We're also looking to purchase, as our sixth item, Motorola portable repeaters, and there will be five of these purchased. The North Carolina Viper 800 megahertz system has been proven to be 90 to 95% effective in street use. With the importance of emergency traffic transmission, The purchase of these portable mobile repeaters will be needed to boost our radio coverage. These units will be placed on command staff vehicles within the county's emergency service fleet. The seventh item we wish to purchase are Motorola lapel microphones. When we started this process, the state gave each county a set of radios, 25 portables and one mini console when they went statewide with their Viper 800 megahertz radio system. These radios did not have the lapels, and these lapels will offer us better field use. The eighth item and the last item we were wishing to purchase with this grant is desktop communications console with three additional channels. This will allow for a continued interoperability with Burlington City Communications via our county emergency operations center. The purchase of this equipment will allow us to further enhance our communications both in terms of interoperability and coverage area. Answer any questions that you have at this time.
I have one. Just asking a question.
Yes,
what
ma'am.
What are battery gain chargers? What are battery gain
chargers? Basically, they allow us to charge six batteries at a time, a gang of batteries at one time, so we can keep them refurbished in our command vehicles in case we need an extra battery while out on the scene.
And they are needed sometimes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. They are needed sometimes for long events, very long incidents.
Sorry, Glory Hallelujah's playing, but it ain't mine. Any more questions for Mr. Leonard?
Whose is it?
That'll pay.
No questions.
No. I think it sounds good.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I think the sheriff is using the same system, are you not?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Good. Okay. Next thing on our agenda is the county manager report.
Just a couple of updates. There's a couple workshops we're going to have to set up the next month or so. Hopefully, Orange County is meeting tonight to talk about the dispute with the county line issue. And as soon as we hear from them, we'll try to set up another meeting and a joint meeting between both boards. So I haven't heard anything different, but they're supposed to be meeting tonight, if I'm not mistaken. The other issue is a meeting with Doug McKinney and Park. They're moving forward with their park and ride areas with inside the city of Burlington. And if he would like to sit down and talk with us about our possible joining part as a full member, what the park and rides will do and its effect on Alamance County. And this would not be a joint meeting with Burlington. This would be just a meeting with the Board of Commissioners. So we're going to try to set that up in the very near future. That's all I have this evening.
Will that be a public meeting?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any questions of Mr. Honeycutt? Okay. Does anyone want to pull anything on the consent agenda?
I would. I'd like to pull B, budget amendments 10 and 11. I thought we decided that we wasn't going to have budget amendments on the consent agenda. It was supposed to be on the regular business meetings.
Which ones were those?
I know
you changed it, but you know, I just.
Well, we can pull it. I mean, anything.
When you're talking about money, you shouldn't be on the consent agenda. I know y'all, you Democrats, like to spend money, but
yeah, don't be bad.
Yeah,
me
not.
Well, get that. Get that down. No,
he's right. It wasn't on there. It passed.
Okay, we're gonna pull. Item number B and I think.
Well, I'd like to know what it is.
Sheriff, I think he
Sheriff,
wants to.
Sheriff, can you address these?
Tell us where you're throwing our money away on.
Okay, there is one in there, I think, for $12,000 from federal drug seized assets to be transferred over. That money is to be used to finish up our Pine Street project, a house that the county gave the sheriff's office for office space, and we're paying for all the renovations out of drug seized monies.
Where is that project now, Sheriff?
Where is it at?
Yeah,
we're getting ready to put windows in it, and I think the heating, air, all that stuff done. And this money is to put siding and new windows in.
So it's just about ready then?
Yes, ma'am. It should be ready shortly.
So it's going to make it energy efficient?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So, and the other one, it's the state, Greg, you want to mention that one too?
Yeah.
Okay. We had some money to purchase cars with, but we were lacking $9,000 to finish out a purchase of a car. So we transferred that from the state drug seize monies from the state to purchase automobile.
Didn't have any clunkers.
Both of them look like money well spent.
Well, thank you,
Commissioner Lashley.
Is this difference from what was in the budget that we voted for back?
Yes, ma'am. What we did, they were 7 cars given to us in the budget. And we, I don't know how to say this, but there's been 2, the ones we have been wrecked and total loss. Of course, they were older cars, and we're having to replace them. We're trying to do it out of drug seized monies.
So that, okay. See, Bill asked to pull it. I didn't.
That's okay.
That's good.
We don't have it. Now, can we put it back on?
Yeah.
Okay. And, okay.
Is that it?
I do have one question on the Lakeview subdivision property. Do they know about this, that we can't fix it? Or are we going to fix the lake?
Here's
the
Jason right here.
No.
Thanks, Jason.
Right. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
It's who you after? Who, Lakeview?
Well, I thought we had one about, we're going to talk about paving the road out there.
That's F.
Oh, okay.
That's
yeah.
Jason Martin.
Right.
Oh, okay. Is that Jason, the Lakeview subdivision?
Yeah, won't
yeah.
you?
Yeah, can
tell
you do
us
that?
What that is, Jason.
That's the one. I just want everybody to know what this is about, and I don't know if the citizens even know about this, do they, Jason? It is Lakeview.
I believe it, Madam Chair and Commissioner. So, 2 meetings ago, I believe the citizens came out that night and expressed their concerns about the conditions of the roads in Lakeview subdivision. And the resolution that you have in front of you tonight is it's basically a resolution giving me authority to write a letter on behalf of the citizens to the Department of Transportation.
All right.
With support and for their request to be included in the secondary road system for road maintenance through the state. What it does not do is it does not put any money in at all from the county. As a matter of fact, I believe the wording in that is that the county does not have any financial liability or responsibility with road maintenance.
All right.
And so that's what the resolution is basically for, and it's citing in the administrative code where this is a non-system public road. It was platted prior to 1975, and under the Department of Transportation's administrative code, they have to consider that to be taken into the maintenance system. Doesn't mean they have to take it in, but it means they have to consider it if they petition them. And this is just us going ahead and lending that support to them.
Yeah, I just wanted the citizens to know that if
right.
they don't know it.
Actually, I did call in Spaceton and talk
okay.
them.
Okay. And I mean, I knew what it was. I just wanted to make sure that everybody understood what it was about.
Okay. I'm trying.
Okay. And that I didn't take it off. I just wanted to say. Any questions about that? Okay, if we are okay with the consent agenda, I'll entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda.
Move.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay, commissioner's comments. We'll start on the end.
Yes, I'd like to. Eddie, on your retreat with the school board, they've had some news releases lately about them wanting to take school lottery money that was left over from the bonds, and I believe there's a third source.
Stimulus money.
Yeah, I knew there was 3. I couldn't think of the third one.
Right.
And I understand they've got 30 classrooms that they're going to. First of all, did they discuss that issue?
They did talk about it very briefly. Mr. Wallace gave his presentation of what they're wanting to do. They didn't really make any moves on it, of course, but they were discussing that.
Are they going to have to buy land, or?
Well, they are in the market for some land.
For
yes.
that.
The Times News did a really good article of it, right. I think, over the weekend. It I thought was really interesting,
right.
and y'all did a
for
good
the
job.
Technical Center and taking those funds.
I'm all in favor of that. I think that's what.
Well, the question that I had was that they're stating that it's not going to affect capacity numbers. In other words, it's not going to help capacity numbers at all. In other words, you're going to build a $7 million structure, yet you're not going to affect capacity in the total picture in a positive manner. I mean, over in Greensboro, they've got Weaver Academy, which is a lot like what this could be. And the students, a lot of the students that go to Weaver stay there all day long, and it definitely helps capacity. So, you know, I'm real concerned.
I think what it might do is free up, you know, like all the school or all the high schools have shop classes that they do there at the school. So that will open up some spaces. Now, I don't know how they'll go about using that space to do classes in, but it may open up some building space that they don't have at the present.
See, one thing that I don't think that we're doing is asking enough questions to get an analysis of the total use of the floor space that they've got in the schools. When we met with the school board over there, you know, if you look at the total list of classrooms that are available in each school, and then go in and see how many classrooms are actually being used all day long, you're going to get some funny numbers. And, you know, I asked the question at a meeting that we attended, the last one with them, you know, you've got 20 classrooms in a given school that's not used as general classroom space. Can you tell me during the day what percentage of those classrooms are full? You say, and they can't give you these numbers. And any business could give you those numbers. And that's why I think we've got to ask more questions before we approve.
Yeah, and I think we do too.
On this angle too.
The concept I think is really fantastic because we need a service. We need to educate our people in high school that don't, everybody don't go to college. And I think it's a great idea to teach technical. You know, one time we had a technical college of elements. And, you know, I graduated, and look how smart I am. And, so, you know, it's a great opportunity to get our educated people that aren't going to college. I think it's a great idea.
I think the concept's good. I think you're right. We need to find out.
There's
what
a lot of questions
with that space. Yeah.
Agree, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'd like to know.
Not only with that addition, but how they're utilizing what current structures they've already got. Because they're going to come to us wanting to build new school and add on to schools and so forth. And I mean, they've got one school where almost one third of the school is not being used for regular classroom space. And they blame it on other programs. And, you know, I think we've got to ask some serious questions.
I don't know that. Now, I'm hearing on one hand that ACC is filled, they're packed. But this technology school, I don't know why these kids, they're going to bus them from the home schools to the school, right? Why can't they bus them over to ACC for morning classes? Because originally in these plans, they're not planning to have lunch. They're just going back to that home school.
I don't really know, but I know working with the high school carpentry kids, they're not at the level they are at ACC. So you do have a...
Yeah, there's
you got
gap.
A difference of students there that... And they're limited in what they can do as far as skill training.
Yeah. They're basic skills in high school. And you, as they develop in the way they use their hands and their brains, they're going to get better. I think it's a great idea.
Yeah, I don't have any problems with the concept as long as it's analyzed
right,
better than what I think we've seen so far.
And long as they don't have the same thing ACC has, because... You know,
it'll be the same thing, but the
in a different.
Technical.
Well, they already have a carpentry class in the high schools now.
Yeah.
And they have a more advanced carpentry training at ACC.
Okay. Any more commissioner comment? Okay. How about announcements? I would like to say that when we were in California, we went to the Anaheim Family Justice Center. I did want to mention that. And I have pictures, and I've actually spoken to the Grand Rotary Club and talked about it. And I'm speaking to the Burlington Kiwanis Club this month and talking about the Family Justice Center that that we're going to build here, and it's certainly well worth. The police picked us up at 10 o'clock on Monday morning. We didn't get in till late Sunday night, and the police picked us up Monday morning in a paddy wagon. I'm kidding. But anyway, it did not have Anaheim police on it, but the Patrick picked us up and took us over. And we were there over about 2 hours at least, and I have some pictures.
Bob,
of
you
it.
Heard it on the paddy wagon.
But and then he brought us back to our hotel. But it was very well worthwhile going through that and seeing what they do and how it works out there. Now, we don't have Disneyland, and I didn't go to Disneyland. We do not have Disneyland here because evidently that's one of their big people that give them a lot of money. But we got a Walmart here. We got a lot of things here that we can probably get some things for this Family Justice Center as well to make it look good and make it a family-looking place, and that's exactly what they have out there. So there are only 30 of these in the United States. We will be the first one in North Carolina. San Diego has one in Anaheim, and I don't remember. I do have that. If anybody wants to see it, I have that copy that shows where they are. We did go to training every day after that. Actually, one day they made us bring our lunch back and eat it during the training session. So we all, Barry Bass and I went to two mental health conferences. And since I put myself on the mental health board, and it was very, very enlightening what we listened to. And all of us went every single day out there to the meetings, and it was very rigorous because at 8 o'clock we had to be there, and one day it was about six, wasn't it, Craig, when we got through, and we had to go from place to place. And what we did on Monday was we sat down and we decided who was going where, because they had so we couldn't even fit into every single training session that they had out there. So we all went to different training classes just about. So just wanted to tell you that. It was very interesting to do this. And to me, it's well worth it to get this money back in Alamance County to go to these things. And even if it is a mandatory thing, it was well worth us going out there. So we did go to all the classes.
Do they have any centers on the East Coast?
That
you can remember off
hand. I don't know. I'm thinking but I don't. There's some up north that maybe on the East Coast, but there's 30 in the United States. So we know California's got two, but it's and maybe more. I don't know. They may have another one out there. I don't know. But most of the real coal states don't have them, like North Dakota, South Dakota. I was looking at, I can get you a copy of that if you want it. I have it at my house.
Interesting if all of us had a copy just in our own package.
I will certainly get you a copy and have it in your package to show you where these sites are. Okay?
Yeah,
and Craig may have his here. I don't know. I got mine at home.
Right.
Okay.
Linda, I do have one quick comment.
Okay.
This Thursday, United Way is having a kickoff at the Bend Court that we okayed a grant for them to put the road in for Habitat. And it's going to be Thursday at 8 o'clock. Anybody's welcome to come. It's $5, 8 in the morning. So you got to get out.
Where is it?
It's on Bend Court. Where the,
oh, where we were down there that day when it was raining so hard.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's Thursday morning.
Okay, I know where that's in.
And that's for the United Way Habitat bill that's coming up next week.
Okay, no announcements? If not, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.